In the early 1980s, an unknown group had just purchased something like 64,000 acres of land in Central Oregon, and they intended to bring thousands of people here.
At that time, it didn't seem like a big deal. It was just another religious, spiritual group buying land in the outback somewhere. It was sort of a non-event.
There was all this anticipation, all this excitement of coming, that I can just go and be there. So just driving down, the land was just magical. It just has a certain mystery about it. It's nestled down among the hills with mountains around, and it just feels like a very special place.
You know, I don't think we grasped at that point a fraction of what was about to happen.
The initial media coverage was very positive. Here was a new group. They'd come in on a ranch where the soils were pretty exhausted and worked at least 12 hours a day. In fact, that was part of what some of them said is, our work is our worship.
We were fascinated with them and what they were doing, because some of the things they were doing were way ahead of their time. They were in the forefront of organic farming.
This is overgrazed farmland and little trickle creeks that have been neglected and polluted, and we just came and restored that, restored the beauty of the land, built a dam.
All of a sudden we were struck by how much had been done on the ranch. There was construction everywhere, and it had grown from, you know, the first time we were there, and there may have been a dozen people that we saw. Now all of a sudden there were hundreds of people, and everybody wore red, which we thought was a little wacky, but, you know, all of a sudden the story seemed like this could be a fun story to cover.
It was such a love affair. It was such enthusiasm, such joy, and we worked such long days, but you just had the energy to do it, which could be why so much was created in such a short time there.
The doctors would be out in the field picking vegetables. Our professions that we had from our degrees were or were not applied, depending on where we were. And it seemed to suit us.
These people were fabulous people. I mean, they were all people you wanted to take home with you. They were friendly, good-hearted, intelligent people that weren't sure why they were there, but something had drawn them to this place and Bhagwan Sri Rajneesh. And they were dedicated to that. I mean, they were sunk deep in that.
We wanted a community on some land that we could live peacefully and create. So when we first went, I think there were congenial relations among the people, and I think Sheila and those people made an effort to make friends, to be good neighbors. What seemed to change was when it became clear to do the things that we wanted to do on the land, we had to incorporate as a city.
They wanted to build a big city. And where they were building currently was not their plan for the big city. Their big city was up on the hill, and it was a huge city. And they could not get a building permit.
And that was the whole reason of going into Antelope and saying, well, if we can't have a city here, we're going to go and become part of the government in Antelope. So then it was a big takeover, you know, now we're trying to take over Antelope. But it wasn't. I mean, it was something we were forced to do in a way to have a city. And this is when Sheila made some moves that Osho didn't approve of, and some of us were quite shocked by and wondered about her methods. And one of these was collecting homeless people and busing them in with the idea that then they could be registered to vote and we could sway the vote in the Dow's election and get some sannyasins on the council, and then they could implement through the laws.
Their plan was actually semi-brilliant. Pull a bus up to a downtown corner, you know, full of homeless people and say, hey, we'll feed you, we'll clothe you, you don't have to work, you can just hang out, you know, we'll take care of you. And, you know, people piled on these buses and thousands of people came to Rajneeshpuram.
When Sheila found out that, I guess they changed the Oregon law then, that they weren't going to be allowed to vote, then she quickly started moving them.
Right after the election, all of the homeless people were gone. At first, it was just a bunch of people got sick in the Dalles, and it was just another food poisoning at a fast food restaurant. You know, the Rajneeshis, you know, nobody thought about that.
The salmonella poisoning, that, again, that was part of the sinister way that Sheila really used an outlaw tactic to try to keep people in that area sick so that they couldn't vote.
This was an occasion of the largest germ war attack on any peaceful city probably in the history of the world. It was the largest use of wiretapping and eavesdropping technologies in an illegal way. It was the largest immigration fraud, violation of the United States immigration laws. It was full of assassination plots against government officials.
It just doesn't seem like it took very long at all that all of a sudden there were guns. The peace force, they called them, they were carrying Uzis. There was a strata, you know, there were the organizers, you know, the Rajneesh government, and there were the worker bees. And the worker bees were completely in the dark.
You felt this separation, like that they're the bosses and we're the workers. And when I first went there, they started that with me. Like, I offered some suggestions of something, and they said, well, you know, if you don't like this, you can leave. And, of course, you want to be there.
The large number of people simply followed, barely blindly, the directions of their leadership, even though they were intelligent and well-educated enough to have gone their own way. They didn't, because they surrendered themselves to this larger religious force in their lives.
The government was trying to implicate Osho in the things that Sheila did, whereas Osho was the one that had asked the police and all the investigators to come in and to determine if there had been any wrongdoing.
When their leaders turned out to be exposed as corrupt and lawbreakers, there was an enormous amount of denial. And then there was a huge sense of personal loss and disaffection of those who felt entrapped and then abandoned by their leadership.
In the end, some of the leaders, like Sheila, fled. And Sheila was sort of the glue that held the whole thing together. And when she left, the place really started to collapse.
Numbers of people either left the movement, but they certainly all left the commune, and it was incapable of maintaining its intensity.
Some people took it as, we're here, we put all our money in it, all our work, all our love, and we're going to live here the rest of our lives. And they just felt like they got the rug pulled out, that Osho kind of let them down.
It was a utopia for them. It was where they wanted to be for the rest of their lives. And it was gone. And it fell very quickly. It collapsed very quickly.